Hoorah for the old stock saddle. Hoorah for the stock whip too. Hoorah for the bully pony boys to carry me westward ho. To carry me westward ho, my boys, that's where the cattle stray. On the far Baku where they eat Nadu, 1,000 miles away.
I wonder if the name A.L. Lloyd means anything to you. It's been familiar to me for 20 years or so. First as an important writer about folk music and folk songs, and then as a great folk singer whose voice was familiar to me on a dozen or more discs. Then last year in London I went to visit him, and A.L. Lloyd became Bert Lloyd, and I learnt a lot more about him. That he was born in London in 1908, that his father was a docker, that both of his parents died shortly after the First World War, he was left without family, and he was sent out to Australia. And out here, he worked as a station hand in Western New South Wales. And after his years in Australia, 10 years or so, he shipped out to sea, he sailed aboard whalers, and then by some extraordinary mechanism, which is perhaps peculiar to the British scene, he became a full-time writer and one of the greatest folklorists in the English language. Now, while he was working on sheep stations and as a whaler, wherever he was, he picked up songs from the men he was working with. He didn't only learn their songs, he also learned the traditional styles in which they sang, and that's the way he still sings. And on top of all that, I found in London that he was a good bloke. So I was very excited when I heard that Bert Lloyd was coming out here. And I thought that there were two things I'd like to do. I'm an historian, and I thought it would be interesting, historically, to take him back to Condobolin in Western New South Wales, where he had worked as a young man, where he hadn't been, of course, since about 1932, and then to take him down to the Kelly country, which he'd never seen, but which I was quite familiar with.
Bert.
Hello there, how are you?
Good trip?
Fine.
Good, nice to see you.
Come on, we can
go through. Hoorah for the old stock saddle. Hoorah for the stock whip too. Hoorah for the bully pony boys to carry me westward ho. To carry me westward ho, my boys, that's where the cattle stray. On the far Baku where they eat Nadu, 1,000 miles away. Then give your horses rein across the open plain. We'll crack our whip like a thunderbolt, nor care what some folks say. And running we'll bring home the cattle that now roam on the far Baku and the
We made for Condobolin, where Bert Lloyd, many years ago, as a young boy, met his first Australian station owner, his new boss.
I thought he was one of the station hands. I was asking him all sorts of questions about what the boss was like and so on, and I'd been working for some tigers, really, and I asked him some pretty penetrating questions, I guess, and might have given the impression I was a bit finicky about bosses. Of course, when I got to the station, I found he was the boss. He'd been pretty non-communicative most of the go. And it turned out he was the boss. But still, he wasn't too bad at that. I got on rather well with him.
The boss was your only contact, was he?
My only contact?
In Condobolin.
In Condobolin. Oh, yes. And he was no contact. That is, I'd been sent here from the Labour Exchange, you see. And I knew nobody else, no, when I arrived here. And, of course, compared with the towns in the southeast, this in those days looked a bit bleak, a bit barren to my mind. I wondered what I was walking into.
What did you want to make of your life in those days, Bert?
Oh, make of my life? I suppose I thought I was going to be a station hand all my life, but at the same time, there were so many things I wanted to find out about then, you know. I wanted to find out something about books, something about music, something about pictures, all that sort of decorative thing, if you like. And it wasn't difficult to do so in the bush in those days. I don't know how it is now. Perhaps there's more distractions now.
The backyard of the commercial hotel. It's a pub with no beer these days and no customers either.
It's the pub I remember best, in fact. It was about the first pub we came to as we rode in, and so we just hitch our horses outside, and we'd be set. I have many recollections of this pub, one way and another.
Well, who was the landlady?
Well, I never knew her name, but she was a very nice woman. And I remember her very clearly. One evening, Saturday evening, I was in the bar and she must have felt I looked a bit lonely. And she invited me up onto the veranda with her, onto the front veranda. It was a quiet evening. And she played me the gramophone, I remember, just, I suppose, to cheer me up. And I can even remember the piece she played. I remember it was a very starry night, and the piece she played was a record of the old grandfather clock song, you know, the song that says, that ends, and it stopped short, never to go again when the old man died. I remember it was sung by Frank Crummett. It just shows you, doesn't it, what silly things hang in your memory and all sorts of important things fall out.
Well, these were Depression years, Bert. Did the Depression hit you very much? Were there many blacks on the track?
There was work around here for station hands, I think. I don't think it was hard to get work. On the other hand, there were an awful lot of swaggies coming through all the time, yes. Some of them eccentric old boys with long beards, and some of them eccentric young fellows at odds with society. I remember one evening I was skinning a sheep, and two young fellows came along, stood around waiting for me to cut them off a chop. It seemed they were battling their way all the way from Queensland down to South Australia. And seeing that I was interested in songs, I didn't see why they shouldn't sing for their supper if they had any songs. So I asked them. They'd come a long way. I thought they might have picked up something on the track. And they sang me the song of Wallaby Stew, that old song. Next morning, I found my good skinning knife was gone, but still, I had the song in exchange, and so I suppose it wasn't too bad a bargain. It says,
poor old daddy got 5 years or more, as everybody knows, and now he lives in Maitland jail, brought arrows on his clothes. He branded old Brown's clean skins, and he never left a tail. So I'll relate the family's fate since Dad got put in jail. Sister, the wallaby stew, make soup of the kangaroo time. Get your ride to the end of the highway, where the neon points to wood. Come on, the rising wind, we're caught up around the bend. Ooh. You can find the perpetual motion. Fix your mind on a crystal day.
Good evening. Thank you.
What's your
fitness? Wait till I get my glasses.
T-bone steak and tomatoes, rump steak and egg, T-bone steak and egg, ham and egg. It's a standard sort of menu.
I'll have a cup of tea to start, and I think I'll order later if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Just a cup of tea to my darling.
Cup of tea to start with you.
Good. Thank you. Fine.
How often did you get into town?
Oh, I suppose about once in 6 weeks we used to ride in. It was a 20-mile ride. It was a long ride. We used to ride in, get our hair cuts, have a bit of a booze up. Not much. We were all very moderate drinkers then. The shearers used to put us to shame in that respect. They were much more diligent drinkers than we were. We'd sort of hang around town, do some small shopping. And we'd knock off, you see, Saturday lunchtime, be in by very late afternoon, ride out again towards Sunday night, just as people were going to bed, summer nights, going to bed on the verandas. There'd be all the mums and the girls in nightgowns just getting into bed. We knew them, we'd ride past saying, good night, Mrs. Jones, good night, Emmy, and so on, and away. There's a little township not far from here, you are belong.
Well, yeah, it's 40 miles up the road. I saw it on the map this morning.
Did you? Well, they used to have shearing shed dances, station dances there. Seems they were very lively, too. Lively enough for someone to make a song about them. The song was on the go in this neighborhood in my time. It goes like this. Oh, who hasn't heard of you, Abalone Ball? We're the lads of the Lachlan, the great and the small. Come bend on diversion from far and from near to cast off their troubles for just once a year. Like Stringy or Weathers, the shearers in force, or Rush to the bar as a matter of course, while waltzing is Kleiner, the manager cursed, cause someone had caught him a jab with the spurs. Oh, the boundary riders was frisking about, but the well sinkers seemed to be feeling the drought. If the water was scarce, well, the whiskey was there, and what they couldn't drink, boys, they rubbed in their hair. And so on. Sounds a lively dance, anyway.
Well, you couldn't have rubbed too much of that whiskey in your hair, Bert.
No, it didn't do me much good, did it? I was sent to muster a lot of sheep out of a paddock here on Bougainvillean. When the fire came over the hilltop, it was quite clear that I wasn't going to be able to get out through the gate myself, let alone run the sheep out. I hopped off the pony and started running, and I became aware that there was a fox running beside me, almost tripping me up, just running for company. And I looked back to see whether the fire was gaining on me, and it certainly was, because it just licked across my forehead and burnt it, and I fell head over heels into a dry creek, and the whole thing blew over. I don't know what happened to the fox, I'm sorry to say. He wasn't down in that creek with me. I think he's still running. The pony was unhurt, although most of the horses around there looked like rhinoceroses. They'd lost their ears and their heads were so swollen up, we had to shoot them. Ordinarily, station hands would not enter the part of the homestead where the boss lived. That would be considered virtual sacrilege, I suppose. None of us complained much, but some of the old-timers, who were full of bush traditions, and who perhaps as casual workers felt they were getting the dirty end of the stick, they used to use resounding terms sometimes, saying, if things don't alter for the better around here, I'm going to run a red steer through this property, things like that. You know, the old saying that the Australian pastoral system is patriarchal despotism tempered by Bryant and May, wasn't that it? I don't know who said it. I got impatient with the blokes I was working with because I was short of conversation with them. You know, they didn't want to discuss the kind of things that I was rather eager to discuss so that I could find out more about books and pictures and such. But now I realized that they had a lot to teach me. They knew a lot about stock, about horses, and if I'd stuck it out a bit longer and got over my period of impatience, I suppose I'd still be chasing sheep to this day. This is the old forge, where in my time it was mostly saddles, bridles, a whip or two hanging up. Of course, now there's not so many horses on the place. They have a different kind of gear. It's all mechanical gear now, as you see. This little hut here, now used as a dump for any odd bits of machinery about the place, it seems, used to be my home. I had my bed stretched along the corner and a few pictures nailed up on the wall. And on one box was the little portable gramophone I bought with the records stacked up in the box underneath it. It seemed to me very cozy. In fact, looking at it now, it looks a bit bleak and bare, and you might say it was rough living. But it's always possible to make that kind of place snug. Just around the back here, this is the old horse yard, of course, in my day. It was a wooden slab yard, I suppose of some importance to us, since it was always the focus of our early morning instructions. Thank you.
Very good. All right.
Well, I still pack up a vacuum.
Sure in the share and shed, and it was a dream of joy for everyone, and their house about was a girl dressed up as a boy, dressed up like a page in a pantomime, and the prettiest ever I seen. They'd flaxen hair, they'd coal black hair, and every shade between. There was short, plump girls, there was tall, slim girls, prettiest ever I seen. They was 4 foot five, they was 6 feet high, and every shade between. The shed was cooled by electric fans that were over every chute. The pens were of polished mahogany and everything else to suit. The huts had springs to the mattresses and the tucker was simply grand. And every night by the billabong, we danced to a German band. Our pay was the wool on the jumbuck's back, and we shore till all was blue. The sheep was washed before they were shore, and the rams was perfumed too. And we all of us wept when the shed cut out, in spite of the long hot days. For every hour them girls waltzed in with whiskey and beer on tray. There were three of them girls to every chap, and as jealous as could be. There was three of them girls to every chap, and six of them picked on me. We was drafting them for the homeward track and sharing them out like steam. When I woke with me head in the blazing sun to find it a shearer's dream.
Well, here we are in the sheds at last, Bert. How does it compare with last time?
Well, there are many fewer stands than I remember. We had about 14 or 15 stands. The shearers were much closer together. When I was here, of course, a lot of it has gone over to wheat now. Sheep are scarcer. Wheat is more prominent, and I guess that's why. But otherwise, the shed's much the same. It's a good, solid, old 19th century shed.
Whose shed was it?
When I was working here, the station was owned by some people named Stevenson, and they've been immortalized in folklore. Because there's a song about a drunken shearer, and he's identified, he's located as working in this very shed. A bit of the song goes, what has happened, I'd better explain, is that the shearer staggered into the bar, and the barman is so sick of him, and the shearer says, whatever you got to me, just sling me the first. And it happened that the barman was cleaning the bar with sulfuric acid. So he shoves the sulfuric acid across to him. The shearer pours it out, drinks it, and the song says, it ain't down in history and it ain't put in print, but Bluey drank acid with never a wink, saying, that's the stuff Jimmy could. Strike me stone dead, this'll make me the ringer of Stevenson's shed. It's weird. You're faced with peculiar dilemmas, almost, of what you remember, what was real, what is sheer mythology.
Were the Kellys still a part of the living folk legend when you were here?
Well, there were a number of little pulp books with the adventures of the Kellys that were mostly read by the kids. But as far as the real bush lore was concerned, the bush rangers of the Forbes Goldfields, for example, in the 1860s or so, like Frank Gardner, for whom many of the old-timers had great affection. It's all about bold Frank Gardner, with the devil in his eye. He said, we've worked before us, lads, we've got to do or die. So blacken up your faces before the dead of night, and it's over by your Yugara rocks, we'll either fall or fight. You can sing of Johnny Gilbert, Dan Morgan and Ben Hall, but the bold and reckless Gardner, he's the boy to beat them all. So now off go the rifles, the battle has begun. The escort started running, lads, all in the setting sun. The robbers seized their plunder, so saucy and so bold, and they're riding from Yugara rocks encumbered with their gold. You can sing of Johnny Gilbert, Dan Morgan and Ben Hall, but the bold and reckless Gardner, he's the boy to beat them all.
We're towards the end of the trip now, Bert, and we're in Beechworth, and it's always seemed to me that something ended in Beechworth and something began in Beechworth, and specifically in Beechworth Jail, that what ended was Ned Kelly's life as a free man, and what began was, if you like, Ned Kelly's life as a free spirit, the beginnings of the legend. For a lot of people, Ned Kelly is just a part of the Australiana business, the books and the pictures and the ashtrays and all this sort of thing. We've been through the Kelly country, we're at Beechworth. What do you think about it now?
As far as Kelly is concerned, he certainly is one of the notable, vivid Australian mythological heroes. Whatever one thinks of his character, the general representation is of a hero who would battle against odds, against authority, and go down fighting. Australia is a new country still, and new countries need their firm mythology to start with, and Kelly is part of that mythology. Some might say a negative part, but still part of that mythology. New countries need mythological heroes as a source of encouragement, as help to face the hard facts of life.
The sergeant and three constables rode out from Mansfield Town at the end of last October to hunt the Kellys down. And four of them rode out and only one came back. And over there's the memorial to the three who didn't come back. And on the side it says that they rode out in pursuit of a band of armed criminals. No names, no pack drill. But folklore, the folk process, has made heroes of the criminals rather than constables. And indeed the memorial is usually known as the Kelly Monument.
There's one Kelly ballad that begins, it was in November 78, the Kelly boys come down. After shooting Sergeant Kennedy, they rode into Euroa Town to rob the bank of all its gold was their idea that day. Blood horses they were mounted on to make their getaway.
Wombat Ranges, and there's Stringy Bark Creek, and they say that Aaron Sherritt used to be able to sleep out here in his shirt sleeves in the middle of winter, and that Ned was even tougher than Sherritt.
Must have taken some doing. Wonder how they found a way about in this country.
Stringy Bark Creek and the Kelly Tree.
Fine big tree.
Fine tree. Kelly shot Lonergan. I think it was Lonergan that the lines refer to from the ballad. Brave Kelly murmured sadly as he polished up his gun. Oh, what a bloody pity that the bastard tried to run.
How did the police come on?
Well, the police were camped here. They were cooking. The Kellys knew that the police were in the country looking for them. They set out to track the police before police reinforcements could arrive. And
sneaked up on the police before the police could sneak up on them, was that it?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And this was where they opened fire on them.
Well, we covered a lot of ground in 4 days, Bert. It must have been 1,000 miles, I suppose, up to Condoblin and back. I wonder what you made of it all. Do you think there's still a recognisable Australia out there?
There's recognisable Australia there, and at the same time, quite a bit of it is transformed out of recognition for me. You know, on the way up to the station I used to work on, I was a bit discouraged because in bush town after bush town we went through, I couldn't identify anything at all. There was this place of motels and drive-in cinemas and supermarkets and this and that, just like American country towns. Very different from what I remember of bush towns in the past, of course. In my day, for one thing, there were infinitely fewer cars, a lot of sulkies about the place, horses hitched in the back of the stores and so on. And lots of weatherboards, a great deal of unpainted weatherboard when you get up into Western New South Wales. Quite different from these smart, snazzy, go-go bush towns today. In England, of course, we still imagine that the bush thing is very powerful and the sort of frontier mythology of Australia is what determines the Australian character. And this, I guess, is fading very, very fast now. Australia's altering so much. The old one still, I guess, has its power. It still is an encouragement to many Australians who fancy themselves as an independent, loose-limbed lot, not over anxious to bow to legality and...
I think that sounds like a plane.
Connecting with QF851.
That's it. That's our call.
London via Singapore, Karachi, and Rome.
Hark, hark, the dogs are barking. I can no longer stay. The boys have all gone sharing. I heard the publican say. And I must be off in the morning, love, before the sun does shine, to meet the Roma shearers on the banks of the Condamine. Oh, Willie, dearest Willie, don't leave me here to mourn. Don't make me curse and rue the day. Parting with you, Willie, is like parting with me, life. So stay and be a selected love, and I will be your wife.